settings for our latest show could not be further apart despite speaking the same language. One is known for its wine, steak and tango, the other for its sunshine and flamenco. But what they're certainly both well known for now is MotoGP. First Argentina, then Jerez. Welcome to After the Flag.
And how we get the podium?
Mick was definitely more serious.
Dovizioso's not out of a podium. Finish wall came in very, very late indeed.
Dovizioso now having a go at Bradle for the final podium position.
Oh, what a ride by Andrea Dovizioso. Ducati find themselves on the podium in third place. Dovizioso brings the smiles back to the Bologna-based factory with a third place.
So Dovi, obviously great stuff in Austin. Podium, back on the podium finally, you, Ducati back on the rostrum as well. How did you feel, honestly, though? Was it more delight, satisfaction, relief, maybe?
Well, I mean, it was so nice to feel that sensation, but so important for everybody. For the riders, it's always important to go on the podium, but for the teams and all the people working a lot in the last few years, and everybody struggling a lot, so the podium, and how we get the podium with pushing 100% from the first to the last lap. I was quite sick during the weekend, and the track is so hard for everybody. So there was a few mix of conditions, very difficult, and when you are able to get a result, it's something so special.
Did you expect it, honestly speaking, so early on in the year?
No. No, because still now we are not fast to fight for the podium. What happened in Austin was quite strange. I mean, we are closer, so every race in the bike, fortunately, everything can happen, and that is the reality. I mean, we were close, but we wasn't fast enough to fight for the podium, but many riders have a problem, more problems than us with the front tires, and we were able to get a podium.
Big changes this year with Gigi Pellini, of course, taking advantage of the regulations in a way, but it's working. Obviously, we've seen it's working. Can you see now, finally, some light at the end of the tunnel for Ducati?
Of course. I'm positive for that. Because, yes, there was many discussion about the rules, but I already say that, and I want to confirm our speed now is not for the different of the rules. We improved the bike. I mean, I think we were quite slow, so it's quite easy to improve the situation and normal. Still, we're not fast how we want, but we need time. I mean, the Linea arrived just a few months ago, and we have to make a new bike, and during the season is not possible. We are able to work in many places, but not in every place. So we have to be focused and try to use the our package, and now we are closer. We are not fast to start in the same level and fight, but we are really close, so if we keep fighting like in Austin, we are able to make a good race.
It's 10 years now as well since you won that 125 title in 2004. I mean, does it feel like a decade has gone by?
Wow, already 10 years. I really don't feel happened 10 years ago, and this is not good, but it's always a good remember.
What goes through the mind of Andrea Dovizioso? Do you ever go to sleep at night, close your eyes, and just imagine being a winner again? Does it work like that, really, or not?
Win a title.
Or a race, even.
I mean, yeah, sure. This is my target, and already I made a lot of races without any win, but always you are focused in that goal. So 100%, I'm here for fight, and I think the level is so high, the riders are so strong, the bike and the competitor are so fast and so strong, but it's not impossible. And every time I'm going the track, I'm trying to take a risk and to use the packet, to use my experience, and nothing is impossible.
Yes, Pepe, you can see obviously you're making progress. Round three then brought us to Argentina here.
Yeah.
This water's actually about 30 degrees Celsius. You haven't been in yet, have you? But interesting place, isn't it? Lots of horses, lots of dogs as well.
Yeah. I mean, now it's quite cold, but the water is hot. And I mean, I don't know about this place, but I always like to go in a new country, and I'm looking forward to try a new track.
Great. Thanks, Dory. Perfect.
Thank you.
Well, moving on from one rider who's ridden all three bikes, Honda, Yamaha and Ducati, we're going to move on to a mechanic who's worked on all, Alex Briggs.
Hi, Dylan.
Thank you very much for joining us on After the Flag. Now, for anyone who doesn't know, you're Valentino Rossi's mechanic, but you've had quite an interesting past with Mick Doohan as well, Daryl Beattie, but you didn't exactly start in the world of motorcycle racing, did you?
No. Well, I guess I started riding motorcycles myself, but to pay for the hobby, I was a bus mechanic in Canberra in Australia, and did my apprenticeship on the buses, and raced motocross and tried to pay for it by working on the buses. So.
But then how did you get into MotoGP? I'm sure that's a question on many people's lips.
Yeah, it gets asked a lot. I started racing and I thought I had this dream of being a motocross champion, you know. And so I travelled, did all the series in Australia, and I just wasn't good enough. But in doing that, I met lots and lots of people. You know, I met people that had worked all over the world, Peter Laskowski, who had worked for a guy called Jeff Lee, who was riding in Europe for motocross. So I talked to him and said, you know, I'd like to be a mechanic overseas. I gave up my dreams of being a superstar motocross rider. After I had a broken tailbone, I was sitting at home, so I sold my bikes, and I got offered to work for Yamaha in Australia for their motocross team, because of my association and friendship with people that I met travelling.
Yeah.
And through all of that, I approached some people to work overseas in motocross.
Mm-hmm.
And just before I left to go overseas, I got a phone call from Jerry Burgess, who asked me if I'd like to work in road racing. Yeah, I was recommended to him, and they were expanding the team. To include Daryl Beattie,
right?
And they needed somebody, and I said, I don't really have any experience, you know. Like, he said, well, don't worry, we can sack you at any time. I've been on work experience ever since.
So, in terms of world championships, you've been with, you know, especially Mick Doohan in the dominant years,
yeah,
and with Valentino.
Very lucky, but how
do they differ in the garage? I mean, Valentino always smiling. I think Mick seems like a smiling character, but from what I've heard, was he could be also a serious type.
They both have the same desire to win. That's the same in them. I can see that in both of them. They both have this burning desire to win, to be first at everything, you know. Valentino seems to do it through being happy and jovial. He's happy to talk, even up to the start. What you see on TV is generally how he is, you know. He's happy, he likes that sort of that behavior, you know, and his racing is fun.
Yeah.
Mick was definitely more serious, had the same desire, but he seemed to pump himself up sometimes almost to the point of aggression.
Right.
That would get him motivated, and yeah. Just did it a different way.
Now let's focus a bit more on your job for all the sort of techie geeks, mm-hmm, out there. The bike comes to the track in the box, it's assembled,
yeah,
I think, but not generally. Ready. I mean, what's the first thing you do with it?
The first thing we do is start cleaning and considering what mileage it has done. It's very similar to your car at home. You have parts on there that just have a life. And so after the race, we have a mileage on these parts, pull them off, change them, check bits and pieces. We also have race parts that we put on the race bike that are lower mileage than general. So the exhaust pipes or something like that, we put on just before the race,
yeah,
that have a very low mileage. It means it just hasn't been used too much, just to even minimize the possibility of something going wrong even more than normal. And check, we do a lot of checking, and the best way to check is by cleaning.
Right.
If you clean everything, you normally pick up the crack. Every team is different. Our team, we pretty much do what we need to do, whoever's closest to the task.
Right.
You know, we don't have, Bernie's basically primarily the gearbox, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a bit more technical in the last few years, and he's better at it than anyone else,
okay,
so he does that generally. But bits and pieces like suspension and what have you, and when you see in qualifying, we have sort of set jobs in qualifying, but it's not rigid. And Silvano doesn't say, I want you to do this, I want you to do that. He'll say, okay, we're going to change the ride height, which is, you know, the height of the position of the bike, front or rear, this many millimetres. Okay, off we do it. Whoever's around, whoever's near the bench grabs the tools.
Finally then, on the grid, we see you guys out there, Valentino highly concentrated, but also, like you said, still talking to the end. What are you guys essentially prepared for? I mean, because you're there clearly waiting, are you having to consult maybe what happened on the warm-up lap, for instance?
The last check they do is generally the computer. They plug the computer and make sure there's nothing crazy, you know. something hasn't gone wrong, like oil pressure or something. But mainly we just check the chain, because sometimes the chain settles in a bit after you put a wheel in. Okay. That's our biggest stress, make sure the chain is right.
Okay.
It's the thing we do the most. Sometimes you might have to change the tyre for the conditions, or you are tossing up, you're not sure.
Right.
And you arrive to the grid and the guys that you're racing the championship with all have, let's say for example, they all have a soft tyre on, and we go, we've got the hard. I don't know, we're on the cusp, let's race them on an level playing field, we'll change it, you know. Yeah. Those sorts of things.
Okay, fantastic. Well, Alex, that was very interesting. Thank you very much for your time again.
My pleasure,
and
mate.
Best of luck for the season.
No problem. Thank
Cheers.
You. Cheers.
We started our trip in Argentina, and what a MotoGP race it gave us. Probably some of the best first 7 or 8 laps of a MotoGP race we've seen in a long, long time. New track for everyone and low grip levels. It did catch out some riders like Aleix Espargaró and Álvaro Bautista. Marc Márquez didn't get the best of starts, but that arguably made it only that much more entertaining because he had to fight his way through the field. Valentino Rossi was up there fighting with Stefan Bradl, outbreaking each other. Andrea Iannone doing incredibly well. Then once the race settled down, it was Marc Márquez who'd made his way to the front, showing that dominant pace and taking it home to the finish. Jorge Lorenzo had looked to refound something and was doing incredibly well, though his pace was dropping off ever so slightly, and it was Dani Pedrosa who was riding one of the races of his life, arguably. He had been caught up in traffic before, but that didn't seem to bother him at the end. He managed to catch up with Jorge Lorenzo. Excellent pass on the penultimate corner to bring home a Repsol 1-2. Dominant display from Marc Márquez, though it was Dani Pedrosa who set the fastest lap of the race. Jorge Lorenzo coming home in third, and Valentino Rossi ending up in fourth. And so the grid moved on to Jerez, where they thought they had a chance of beating Marc Márquez. It was the one track he had not yet won at in his Grand Prix career. And in free practice 4, there was an inkling that the other guys might be able to do so. Similar race pace, Pedrosa, Lorenzo, Valentino Rossi and Marc Márquez. Qualifying, Márquez was super fast, but they thought in the race they'd be able to keep up. And the first 2 laps were absolutely spectacular. Marc Márquez fighting with Valentino Rossi, Dani Pedrosa with Jorge Lorenzo just behind him. And even behind that, Andrea Dovizioso on the Ducati. Great battle with Aleix Espargaró, Bradley Smith, the likes of Álvaro Bautista and Stefan Bradl. After a few laps though, Marc Márquez started to pull a gap. Valentino Rossi pretty much sticking with him. So the real fight was Dani Pedrosa, Jorge Lorenzo. Lorenzo towards the end dropped off the pace ever so slightly. He'd gone with the medium option front tyre, his teammate Valentino Rossi with the harder option front, which at that point seemed to be the slightly better option. But in the end, Dani Pedrosa managed to get past Jorge Lorenzo and chase down Valentino Rossi. And in the final few laps got very close, and it looked like we may have a repeat of the situation that we did last year with Jorge Lorenzo and Marc Márquez, except this time out it was Rossi versus Pedrosa. Though Rossi, with his past experience of himself doing so and of what Lorenzo did, managed to close the door, slowed the pace right down, upsetting Dani Pedrosa's rhythm, and Rossi managed to win the drag to the line. Though in the end, it was Marc Márquez who stormed to victory, taking victory from the first 4 Grand Prix of 2014.
Can they do to stop him then? A 100th career Grand Prix for Marc Márquez and 100 points in the World Championship. An enormous lead now, 28 points over Dani Pedrosa. That's more than 1 Grand Prix and a race victory. So he really is in a commanding position. 11 further back, Valentino Rossi, and Jorge Lorenzo up to 5th, but 65 points behind Marc Márquez, only 4 races into the World Championship season. That's it then from Jerez, 4 down, 14 to go in 2014. Márquez has won on this side of the pond, on the other side, nighttime, daytime, unstoppable so far this year. We're off to Le Mans next time. Maybe the weather could be something to prevent a 5th victory in a row for the world champion. See you there in 2 weeks' time.